Good morning, YouTube. Well, I'm here to talk about Queen Sugar, Season 2, Episode 5. Okay, so I put the glasses like that. You can see the light is in the glasses, so I've got to wear them so I can read. So, we have to compromise here. Forgive me for looking like an old woman. Okay, so the scene opens with Michael's doing work for volunteer habitat. So, you know, we all know about Katrina, and they're in New Orleans, where Nova lives, and they're helping the community. I guess they go in and they build houses for families. The whole community comes together and builds houses for families. So Micah is working with his aunt in this project. Meanwhile, he's supposed to be at the mill, not at the mill, I'm sorry. He's supposed to be with his mother meeting this therapist to help him get through this situation he went through with the cops. Where he's not really bouncing back. So he's supposed to be there. He doesn't show up. Charlie's sitting there with the therapist, and the therapist suggests that maybe they should talk. And Miss Charlie is not feeling it. She reminds this woman repeatedly, no, I think it'd be a little weird without him here, since we are talking about my son. His name is Micah. And then the woman said, no. Well, I think it helped that we get a better understanding, that I could talk to you. So she starts asking her personal questions. At first, Charlie is resistant to this. But it opens up some things. We're slowly being inundated to this situation with Charlie and her mother. So the subject of control, perfection, being a perfectionist, and doing things right comes up. Apparently, Charlie's mother was very domineering and wanting her to get things right. That's why she's such a perfectionist. So the therapist kind of opens that up. Okay, next thing we see is Ralph Angel, who him and Darla, he didn't seem to have the resentment. At first, I think it was too much for him to handle that she had been working as a prostitute. And she had been a drug addict. They've kind of come past that now. So he's going to hope to have them back as a family. They weren't married, but he offers her, why don't you move back in with me and Blue? Because she's lost her job now and her housing is precarious. She says no. A couple of scenes later, she talks to her sponsor about it. Sponsor is a person who works in 12-step, another recovering addict whom they get together and help each other along. Usually the sponsor has quite a bit more sobriety than the sponsee, which would be Darla. All right, the next thing that happens, so she says she's not going to do that. She wants to prove her independence, that she doesn't need to be dependent on Ralph or any other man for this period. Anyway, Advai tells Hollywood, I like the character, Ralph Angel. He's a good man. But he, you know, we got some issues. Primarily, this getting along with Charlie is his big thing now. So sometimes I think he's kind of got a chip on his shoulder. He was first introduced to us, I didn't like him that much. But after a couple of scenes, I could kind of see the person. Anyway, him and Charlie and about this farm, because he has the knowledge that this farm is actually his and she is running it like it's hers. She's the boss. Okay. So he, Envy picks up something in his attitude and asks him what's going on. And he tells Envy about the letter from his father leaving the farm to him and not the girls. We remember that from last week, Advai does not think it's a good idea that he tells them this, they should go on as a family. Nova doesn't really seem to have an interest like she wants. She necessarily would have to be living on the farm, or she's not as connected as those two are. It's mostly Ralph and Charlie who are really invested in this farm. Anyway, so Advai, okay, first, Ralph told Vi last week, and now Vi is telling Hollywood. Hollywood sees it is a problem, it's an issue, but the Aunt Vi needs to stay out of it herself. They're grown people. This is their land, their family, their problems, and you need to stay out of it. I'm not sure. One thing I'm not sure about, I don't know if Aunt Vi's house is on the property. It seems like they're awful close. They're both out in the country. I know that. But her house may sit on that property as well. Anyway, Hollywood is telling her that they need to be focusing in on what they're doing. Let these young people, they ain't so young. I mean, they're in their 30s. Handle their own business. Okay. Okay, so now Dr. Robert Dubois has showed up. They're working, Nova and Micah are working for Habitat. I think it's called Habitat for Humanity, something like that. That's a real company. And the doctor shows up. Now, this is her love interest. Now, see, love, the live part is very spiritual part. Now, before we saw Nova having sex with all these people, right, in the first season, mostly all these white guys that she wasn't really connected with. She was just having sex with them. And then also the one guy, the married cop, she did seem to have a real relationship with him. But there wasn't the intensity, you know, of the spiritual part of it. So the spiritual part is the magic part. The spiritual part is when there's a love interest, you know, it's going to be something more than having sex. Anyway, he likes her and she likes him. But now he has come back to New Orleans to work with her. So now she knows he really likes her. And they're in a restaurant and he tells them, you know, I like you. It kind of reminded me of the scene out of Mahogany when he puts that. No. Out of Lady Sings the Blues. You young people ain't not going to remember this, but Lady Sings the Blues, there's a scene where Billy Dee Williams is sitting in the audience and Dinah Ross is on the stage dancing, right? She's dancing, picking up dollars with her parts. And he sticks out, I think it was a $20 bill, $100 bill, something like that. He sticks it out and he says, you want mom to fall off? And everybody know they're going to be an item. Anyway, that kind of thing. He tells her that, I really like you. And she gets a phone call from Charlie to cuss her out about this boy missing his appointment. So she kind of leaves him hanging a little bit. You know, whenever you tell somebody, I like you, I love you, whatever the thing is, you want them to respond. When they don't respond, for whatever reason, you're left hanging. So that's kind of where they left it at. She gets this call. She has to go. Charlie tells her she didn't appreciate her making Micah miss this appointment with the therapist. But really, she's really pissed off because this woman has opened up some of her own wounds when she starts asking her about her parenting. Okay. Next thing is Darla. You know, Darla lost her job. See, shut up. God closed one door, opens up another. You got to close the first one to open up the other. She lost a dumb job as a parking lot attendant. And now she has come to Charlie to ask her for leads on getting a job. I don't get the impression at all that she's asking Charlie for a job. She's asking Charlie because Charlie is connected and she knows people. Or maybe she wants to just help her with her resume and give her some leads. Anyway, they start talking, right? Now, Charlie is giving Darla advice about her mother, her relationship with her parents, that she should needs for herself. So she's talking to Darla, giving her advice about mending offenses and things about family. And his advice is really to her own self. This is where she is with her own mother. Anyway, this family stuff is very touchy because now Darla didn't run off. She pushes her a little too hard, a little too fast, and Darla says, okay, thank you. She's very insecure at this point in her life. And she walks out of the meeting, right? Not walks out, you know, abruptly. She just said, oh, no, it's okay. Thanks for listening to me, that kind of thing. All right, so Aunt Vi. Aunt Vi and Hollywood are starting making this business. I did know that after they gave us the hints last week that she had this dream about making pies for a living, starting her own business, and that Hollywood is not working right now, so he would be able to help her. He has some money and so forth. Well, they jump right into the business now. So we skip a few verses, and now we're in the business. But she's making the pies, and now she has to sell. She's not trying to sell pies retail. She's trying to sell them wholesale. In other words, she's trying to sell pies to restaurants, specifically. First day she tries it, and there's a lady there. I'm going to try not to always mention what color people are, just because it's not important to the story. Anyway, it's a white woman. she is just not into a vibe. She's kind of listening out of half of an ear kind of thing. Okay, yeah, give me a call. Don't call us, we'll call you. But I guess the feelings hurt on this first interview. And then the woman kind of tells her, well, after you get somebody else to buy them, then maybe I'll try them. But, I mean, if she had any interest at all, she would at least try the pies and see if she liked them. She didn't go that far. So, she's home and she's in bed. She's depressed. She's depressed because she started off on this business thing and the first day didn't go well. So obviously her man has to go and encourage her. It's only been one day. Get back up on that horse, girl, and ride. Next thing we see, Davis, we got everybody a love interest. You know, we got Nova hooked up. So now we got to get somebody. Equal time, we got to get somebody to Davis. So, Davis, as far as I can piece it together, they're not being very clear about what Davis' situation is. Does he live in L.A.? It looks like he lives in L.A. because he plays for a Los Angeles team, but he also has a home in New Orleans. That's the best I can come up with. Anyway, Davis shows up at this site where his son and Nova are working, not to work, but to actually pick him up. I get the impression he's probably giving money or something. People see him, they recognize him, and so they rush to, get his autograph and all that kind of stuff. And they ask him about the project. And so somebody like him, his interest would be more financial probably. But there's a woman being interviewed as well. I don't know if she's an actress or newscaster or whatever. They're talking to her at first, and there is energy. That magic I was just talking about a minute ago, that spiritual thing that happens between two people, male, female, male, male, goat, whatever, is there between him and this other woman that the people are interviewing. I think she may be an actress, accomplished actress. Anyway, he's looking at her, and she is looking at him intensely. I think that's going to be a little more than just a bang in the hay. It's the same kind of thing that we saw with Nova and the doctor. Okay. Nova next goes to bless Charlie's loft. Charlie's moved into the mill. I'm calling it a loft because it's a huge, big, huge room that they've converted into an apartment. So, Nova's like a spiritualist, and she goes to bless the house. Her and Charlie have a sit down. She's really going to see Charlie. She can tell something's not right with her. And the subject of Charlie's mother come up about her being a perfectionist, her pushing Charlie. And Nova says that your mother made you a control freak. They agree that they're both control freaks. And they have an intimate moment between the two sisters. Right? Okay. Next big thing. This is one of the big things. There's two big things that both haven't happened yet. Okay. The first big thing first of all, let me say this. Davis and Micah play this game on the basketball court, right? There are just two people on the court. I guess it's a school or something. And Davis suggests that, okay, let's play this game. For every three free throw you hit, you can ask me a question. Every free throw I hit, I can ask you a question. At first, Micah resists, he's a teenager, but then he says, fine, because I can ask you a question. So Micah hits the first free throw shot, and he asks his dad, and this actually made me laugh out loud while he asked him. He said, his first question is, are you a sex addict? And so David gets his chance. He said, damn, you jumped right into it, huh? Say, no, I'm not a sex addict. But he, now he's got to be, people don't like this boy because he cheated on, nobody ever likes a cheater, you know. But I can understand where he's at coming from. He's a professional athlete. That means women are throwing, slipping their panties under his hotel room door and all this kind of stuff. At some point you just know you can have what you want, and it's very hard to resist. Now, I mean, people like us, or like me, would say, well, I don't do that. Oh, I would never do that. Oh, that's nasty. But ain't nobody slipping no panties under our doors. You feel me? So he said, I just got used to being able to ask what I want and getting it because I can play basketball. It's an honest answer. And it's the truth. So, yeah, so it's a man-to-man meeting there, meeting of the minds, because, you know, the kids are always wondering, they want to know if you're a sex addict, because I want to know if that's going to be my life. Am I going to get that from you? That's why I don't like your ass. So they have a talk, and he tells them about what it's like to be noted for something and to have women, have access to a lot of women. Okay, so the next big scene is Darla. Okay, she's giving her son I gotta try to talk faster. I don't want this thing to be a half hour. Y'all won't watch me if I go too long. Okay. Darla is giving the boy a bath, right? Blue a bath. Blue has got this doll in the bath. She starts to take offense at the doll because she feels like the doll is representing her. He has got this relationship with this doll because the doll reminds him of his mother, who's a light-skinned woman with long hair. And the doll's a white doll, but still. That's what she feels. That she has been replaced by this doll. And she wants to be in his life now. I want to be here. She's testing things out. She has not accepted moving in with them. But obviously her mind is starting to go there. She's asking her sponsor about it. And now she's trying to replace this doll from his life. So she took it away. A couple of friends of mine, they didn't like that. They thought that she'd leave the kid alone. But I think that most adults would have some concern about him and that doll after about 10, he's 10 years old now. It's understandable how he would get into something like that because, you know, his mother was gone, you know, and he was being raised by his father and all that. But I thought what she did was okay. She took the doll. She took the doll, she threw it away. Not only for her own selfish reason, but at some point he's got to separate from his doll. And you don't want to be a teenager still playing with Barbie dolls. So I guess the right thing to do is let it happen naturally. But it's no guarantee that it would happen naturally. Anyway, so she separates him from his dog. She throws it in the trash. Now, to her credit, when the boy is having a breakdown about this doll, and then Blue is getting all excited. I mean, Ralph Angel is getting all excited about this doll. Now, Ralph Angel, he loves his boy, and he has a kind of a blind spot about certain things, particularly with this doll as part of it. He won't tell Blue no. He won't let anything happen to Blue. He's very protective of him. So he might not be able to be the one that would take this doll away. So Darla tells him, listen, I got to tell you something. I took the doll and I threw it away. And Ralph Angel is hot. What? Are you? How dare you? Where is the doll? So he goes. She tells him where she put the doll in some business downtown, and he goes and dumpster dives for the doll. While he's in the dumpster looking for this doll, cops roll up. Now cops will roll up on you in certain neighborhoods, even here in this big city, dumpster diving. I ain't gonna tell you why I know, but I do. They roll up on you because people's information is in the trash. So people will think, oh, dumpster dive, what's the harm there? Oh my God, why are they bothering that man? People's information is in dumpsters. You got old checks, that's why you have to have shredders. You have to shred all your information. People can go dumpster diving, get your social security number, get all your credit card, get all your bank information. People can get your identity out of a garbage can. So it's okay, the cops stopped him. Cop stopped him, the black and white cop, right? The black cop, first they pull guns on him. The black cop recognizes Ralph Angel. They recognize each other. As it turns out, they're old friends. Now, here's the twist. I didn't get this the first time around. I suspected it the first time around, but I didn't get it. Okay, so Ralph and his cop were talking. And Ralph knew this guy since they were kids. And the guy thanked Ralph Angel because he said he never got a chance to thank him. Because apparently, when this guy, at first I thought the man was gay, right? And then when Ralph got in trouble, he ended up in jail. And the cop was a cop. And that he just didn't out him. And that's why he was grateful for it, right? But a friend of mine brought it up, and then I went back and researched it, checked it out again today. That cop is transgender. And Ralph Angel knew him as a girl. I forget the name, Victoria or something. Anyway, they were raised. That cop was a girl. Ralph, later on in life, they were good friends. Ralph knew his secret. Later on, they ran into each other in jail. One is a cop and one is an inmate. And Ralph did not expose him that he was transgender, actually. It's important. You don't believe me, go check it out again. That's one thing about trans. Okay, I mean, we're still all LGBTQ, so we encounter each other. But female to male, many times it's hard to clock. I'll tell you my own experience. I knew twice it happened. Guys, I knew them for over, one was 2 years and one was even longer. Since I've been in my church, one was even longer. I never knew that they were transgender. I never clocked them, had many conversations, had dinner with them. I never clocked them. So that transition, in my opinion, many times goes, it's more convincing. So he's working. He's living as a man now. All right. Ralph and the cop. Okay, so Darla is trying to explain to Ralph why she took the doll. She buckles, and they go and buy him a new doll, and she tries to dirty the doll up. So he's basically winning the thing. Because I guess she didn't know that he would take it so extremely hard. And Ralph just can't. He just feels like he should keep the doll until he wants to get it up himself. So Ralph wins that argument. They go get another doll. There's no scene where they show us him presenting the doll. But I guess it's just plastic. You should be able to dirty it up a little bit. Unless he recognizes her scars and everything. I don't know. I assume they bought the same doll. And tried to make it a little bit older looking. A doll should look the same. I think they're plastic. Okay, anyway. Okay. Dr. Nova. Okay, Nova and Dr. Dubois. Okay, so at some point, remember she left him hanging. At some point, they have this intimate scene and she tells him, I like you too. See, it's got to be this. Both have to acknowledge each other, because I'm sure he's wondering all this time. She never said, I like you too. I mean, you say things with your eyes, but anyway, so they're a couple. They just met. They only been on a couple of dates, but it's them. Last thing happens is Charlie offers Darla, she calls Darla and she offers her a job. Remember now, Darla was just working as a ticket taker in a parking lot. One of those beginner jobs you can get out of program. And I don't know if her living situation, I think she lives in a trailer. She has her own place. Anyway, Charlie calls her, but in her resume, she said that she had at one point interned as an assistant, office assistant, and she had worked for some company a long time ago. Charlie says, offers her a job as her assistant. It's great. Great for Charlie. Great for the girl. I even kind of teared up at that scene. I thought it was so cute that she had reached out to this girl and given her a chance. She can do a lot more than work in the parking lot. Somebody has to believe in her. It's great news to everybody until she tells that damn Ralph. Now, Ralph has always got an attitude. Okay. So, the last thing they show us is her. She said, oh, I got a job. He said, oh, I know you would, baby, and all this kind of stuff. And then she said, where are you going to work? With Charlie, and then they're free. That's it. That's the end of the show. All right, people. That was episode 5, season 2, Greenleaf.